Got a package full of wishes. A time machine, a magic wand. A globe made out of gold. No instructions or commandments. Laws of gravity. And decisions to uphold. Printed on the box I see. Acme's built a world to be. Take a chance, grab a piece. Help me to believe it. What kind of world do you want? Think anything. Let's start at the start. Build a masterpiece. Care for what you wish for. History starts now. Should there be people or peoples? Money, funny pedestals. Fools who never pay. Raise your arm and choose your steeple. Don't be shy, the satellites can look the other way. Lose the earthquakes, keep the faults. Fill the oceans without the soul. Let every man own his own hand. Can you dig it, baby? What kind of world do you want? Think anything. Let's start at the start. Build a masterpiece. Care for what you wish for. Cause history starts now. Sunlight's on the bridge. Sunlight's on the way. Tomorrow's calling. There's more to this than love. What kind of world do you want? What kind of world do you want? What kind of world do you want? Think anything. Let's start at the start. Build a masterpiece. Yes. Cause history starts now. Care for what you wish for. Start now. Start now.
Good morning. Welcome to the University of Chicago. Thank you for being here with us today. I also want to thank our audiences online and at the university's centers in Delhi, India, and Paris, France, who are joining us live via the webcast. Thank you for tuning in. My name is Sarah Nolan. I'm the Director of International Communications for the university, and I'll be your Master of Ceremonies today. Now please join me in welcoming the President of the University of Chicago, Robert J. Zimmer.
Good morning, and welcome to the University of Chicago. I am pleased to see all of you here this morning, and that both so many visitors and so many members of our community have come to be part of today's event. We're deeply grateful to Richard Haass, the President of the Council on Foreign Relations, for joining us as our featured speaker to share his perspective on the need to better understand what is fueling a new era of violent conflicts around the world. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Haass. I want to thank our colleagues at the Harris School of Public Policy for their role in today's events, and especially the Dean of the Harris School, Daniel Diermeier, for his dynamic leadership that has been essential to realizing a major initiative that I am about to announce. Please join me in recognizing Dean Diermeier. Given that we have gathered here today to talk about conflicts around the world, it is my distinct pleasure to announce that the University of Chicago has received a transformative gift to create a landmark program to study and help resolve global conflicts. This transformative gift and the program it helps create will allow us to apply against this growing and seemingly intractable problem the rigorously analytic, evidence-based, and data-driven approach to inquiry for which the University of Chicago has been well known since its founding. The Thomas L. Pearson and the Pearson Family Members Foundation is donating to the University of Chicago $100 million, a gift equal in size to the second largest in the university's history, to support the creation of the Pearson Institute for the Study and Resolution of Global Conflicts and the Pearson Global Forum, both to be at the Harris School of Public Policy. The Pearson Institute will focus on three main areas: research to understand, prevent, and resolve violent conflicts through evidence-based and data-driven analysis of both past and existing conflicts; engagement of the international policy and academic communities to advance evidence-based approaches and policies. Very importantly, the Pearson Institute will annually convene preeminent international policy leaders and scholars at the Pearson Global Forum to ensure the regular exchange of ideas and to maximize the potential for positive change by bringing together participants from a variety of sectors concerned with global conflicts. And education for the next generation of scholars and practitioners trained in evidence-based approaches to global conflicts. In each of these three ways, the Pearson Institute represents a fundamentally different approach to the variety of global conflicts that the world now confronts. Over many decades, the University of Chicago researchers have helped transform the social sciences through the creative use of quantitative tools. The Pearson Institute represents a critical new chapter in this work, as our faculty and students will bring distinctive strengths to this vital field of study and policy. This remarkable gift and the creation of the Pearson Institute and the Pearson Global Forum signal a determined and unprecedented step in efforts to confront the new era of violent conflicts around the world. They reflect the deep concern that the Pearson family has for this set of problems and the extensive thought that they have put in to how best have an impact on the world. I want to express my great appreciation, both personally and as president of the university, to the Pearsons for this extraordinary gift, their motivations and commitment that lay behind it, and the confidence that they have demonstrated in the Haass School and the university. As part of the $100 million Pearson Family gift, four named professorships will be established in the Haass School. The Reverend Dr. Richard L. Pearson, Professor of Global Conflict Studies, the Ramilly Pearson Professor of Global Conflict Studies, the Philip K. Pearson Professor of Global Conflict Studies, and the David L. Pearson Professor of Global Conflict Studies. The faculty director of the Pearson Institute, who will be a prominent scholar, will hold the first of these named chairs. Please join me in expressing our gratitude and heartfelt thanks of the University of Chicago community to members of the Pearson family. We will be hearing from two members of the Pearson family shortly about their passion for helping to make a difference on this critical issue. In addition to this announcement, we are honored to bring you an outstanding program today, one that offers an advanced look at the concerns that I know will drive eminent and influential work at the Pearson Institute for many years to come. It is now my great pleasure to introduce Thomas L. Pearson, who along with his brother, Timothy Pearson, who will speak later in the program, has led the Pearson family's efforts to make the gift that we are announcing today. In addition to serving as chairman of the Thomas L. Pearson and Pearson Family Members Foundation, Thomas Pearson is a member of the Executive Council of Cohesive Capital Partners, a New York-based direct private equity firm. Previously, Mr. Pearson served 19 years as Senior Vice President for Law, Human Resources and Administration, General Counsel and Secretary of Alliance Resource Partners and Alliance Holdings. Earlier in his career, he was General Counsel and Secretary of McLouth Steel Products Corporation, Corporate Counsel of Midland Ross Corporation, and in private practice with the law firm of Arder and Haddon. Mr. Pearson is active with numerous civic and charitable organizations. In 2012 and 2013, he was the first global benefactor of the Nobel Peace Prize Concert and the Nobel Peace Center in Oslo, Norway, through the Thomas L. Pearson and the Pearson Family Members Fund. He's a graduate of DePaul University, where he received a bachelor's degree in history and communication, summa cum laude, as well as a graduate with honors of the University of Iowa's College of Law. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Thomas L. Pearson.
Thank you, President Zimmer. I appreciate your kind words. On behalf of myself, my brothers, Tim, Phil, who unfortunately was not able to be with us today, and David, as well as my wife, Jacqueline, and other members of the extended Pearson family, we're honored to participate in today's global announcement concerning the creation of the Pearson Institute for the Study and Resolution of Global Conflicts, and the formation of the Pearson Global Forum. Before I proceed further, however, I would like to acknowledge John Androsik for his moving performance of World, if you'd join me. John, clearly music can capture and express that which cannot be said and on which it is impossible to be silent. The Pearson family is honored to partner with the University of Chicago and the Harris School for Public Policy in these groundbreaking undertakings. Our gift is intended to advance the scholarship, understanding, and resolution of global conflicts, and in doing so, to place the Pearson Institute and the Pearson Global Forum at the forefront of public policy deliberations and discussions and the design of policy solutions. Under the auspices of the University of Chicago President, Robert J. Zimmer, and the Dean of the Harris School of Public Policy, Daniel Diermeier, we are absolutely convinced that the Pearson Institute and the Pearson Global Forum will become global voices and leaders in understanding violent conflict and contributing to its prevention and resolution. The Pearson family brought this initiative to the University of Chicago because of the university's reputation and history where rigorous inquiry is applied to the world's toughest problems. The Pearson family, as noted by President Zimmer, has a longstanding interest in the resolution of global disputes and conflicts. As the past global benefactor of the Nobel Peace Prize Concert and the Nobel Peace Center in Oslo, we do have a family legacy of involvement with leaders in this field. We believe today there is no more single issue that is more important than the study of the intersection of war, failed states, terrorism, and economic cataclysms. And more importantly, the response that the design of policies directed toward forming a more peaceful world will have. As to the critical need for the Pearson Institute and the Pearson Global Forum, the facts speak for themselves. Today, as we all know, there's a global refugee and migration crisis. 19.5 million people are refugees worldwide. The UN estimates that more people have been displaced this year than any time since World War II. In total, one out of every 122 people, a total of 59.5 million, is either a refugee, internally displaced, or seeking asylum. To put this in even better context, if this were the population of a country, one country, it would be the 24th largest in the world. In the case of Syria, war has displaced one out of every two Syrians. With 6.5 million displaced within Syria and over 4.1 million refugees abroad. Tragically, the impact on children is even more staggering. Over 51% of the refugee population in 2014 was children under the age of 18. Our charitable gift, a family investment, if you will, in the Pearson Institute and the Pearson Global Forum is undertaken with the purpose of employing the analytically rigorous, data-driven approach pioneered by the University of Chicago and a global perspective to understanding violent conflict. The joint mission of the Pearson Institute and the Pearson Global Forum is relatively straightforward: to contribute to the advancement of a global society at peace, including, first, using the Pearson Global Forum to convene annually leading scholars and policymakers from around the world. The forum's goals are to ensure the regular exchange of ideas, to maximize the potential for impact in preventing and resolving violent conflicts, and to inform public policy. Second, to promote the application of the Pearson Institute's research findings within the academic community and for the benefit of the general public. And third, as importantly, to engage students, scholars, and policymakers through educational programs and academic courses with respect to issues related to global conflict resolution. In addition to an expansive curriculum focused on global conflict resolution to be developed by the university, our gift also encompasses establishing 4 teaching faculty chairs and named professorships, creating the Pearson Fellows Program for Masters of Public Policy students, and creating the Pearson Scholars Program for PhD students. Before I close, I would be remiss in not thanking several people and advisors and counselors who provided critical input to Tim and I throughout this process. Steven Snitzer, Jeffrey Burns, Daniel Shapiro, Neil Kawashima, and George Ledwith. Tim and I thank you. As I shared a few minutes ago, the Pearson family believes that the time to act is now. There is no more important challenge of our time. Waiting is not an option. We have faith in the University of Chicago and the Harris School for Public Policy's ability to steward our gift, and in doing so, to make a significant, a real, and a lasting contribution to the world and to humankind. We can think of no more important legacy for our family. So I thank you. Thank you.
We live in a world where we face a whole variety of new conflicts that we just haven't seen in earlier times.
The idea that we're going to defeat groups like the Islamic State or indeed the Taliban with standard military techniques is for the birds.
Think about what's happening in the world today. No other time since the end of World War II have we seen as many refugees and internally displaced persons than we do today.
Of course, more important than just keeping people alive and keeping them fed is actually resolving the crises so that they can go home again.
We're launching the Pearson Institute for the Study and Resolution of Global Conflicts with a $100 million gift, with the goal of creating the place where leading academics and policymakers can come together to create new, innovative solutions to the resolution of global conflicts.
The reality is that what we're now dealing with is a fantastically complex web of public policy, of military, and indeed of economic challenges. When I was told about the establishment of the Pearson Institute, I was particularly interested because of the legacy of economic work that the University of Chicago has got.
There has always been a commitment to thinking carefully, according to rigorous analytical methodology, thinking carefully about social science problems.
We're bringing together quantitative, rigorous, data-based approaches that have been successful in so many other policy areas to the area of global conflicts.
The timing of this endeavor is so key. The prescriptions are underexplored, and the international community is looking for better ways to act together to address these problems.
Quantitative data is essential for conducting good evidence-based policy. The fact that the Institute wants to make it a priority can really have a big impact.
Everything that we do is focused on evidence-based and results-driven. It's the only way we can evaluate whether or not we are reaching the outcomes we want to see.
Now is the time for the Pearson Institute. We have a tremendous humanitarian cause. We have a new generation of scholars that use data, that use experiments, that use modeling at a level of sophistication that we just haven't seen even 10 or 15 years ago.
Having conversations with academics can be extremely productive and extremely effective in seeking practical solutions.
When I first heard about plans for the Pearson Institute for the Study and Resolution of Global Conflicts, I was thrilled. The people themselves were caught up in these crises. They don't have the luxury of sitting and reflecting on what needs to be done to solve this. We need the best minds.
The dilemmas of policymaking, the unraveling of the states in Iraq and Syria, you are seeing policy questions that demand the most careful thought, and it's going to happen here at the Pearson Institute.
With this investment from the Pearson family, we really have the opportunity here to have a dramatic policy impact in the greatest foreign policy challenge of our time.
Please welcome Dean of the Harris School of Public Policy and Emmett Dedman Professor of Public Administration, Daniel Diermeier.
Thank you. It is rare that one has an opportunity to really make a difference, but today is one of these days. I'm extremely grateful to the Pearson family for placing their trust in the Harris School and the University of Chicago to tackle the most important foreign policy challenge of our time. I also want to express my gratitude to President Zimmer and the Board of Trustees for supporting us in making our vision a reality. And I'm particularly thankful for the team that has worked so diligently over months to make today possible. It has been an honor and a pleasure to work with you on this great task. What a day. When I resumed my role as dean a year and 4 weeks ago, I'm still keeping track, I was struck by the University of Chicago's culture of rigorous inquiry, its intellectual fearlessness, and its potential for addressing the world's greatest policy challenges. Today, in this moment, I believe this more than ever. Today, thanks to the generosity of the Pearson family, we have the potential to do something incredibly powerful, to transform how we think about conflict, to tear down the barriers that often exist between the academy and the policy community, and to have tremendous impact on the lives of literally millions of people around the world. This is why we're here today. This is why I believe so deeply in the mission of the Pearson Institute and the important work we're about to undertake at the Harris School. The creation of the Pearson Institute for the Study and Resolution of Global Conflicts comes at a critical moment for the world. Never has the need been greater to rethink the approach to preventing and resolving global conflicts. From the train stations in Europe to the ruined streets of Sana'a and the other countless on-screen images we've seen in Mandel Hall today, it is easy to despair over the worsening humanitarian, economic, and cultural crises reverberating through the world. But through the power of rigorous inquiry, I know we will help to bring about change. 2 weeks ago, only a couple of days after the ghastly news and images originating from Palmyra, I visited Munich to celebrate my father's 77th birthday. It happened to be one of the days when the refugee trains arrived from Hungary. A continent that was ravaged by two world wars, but finally has found a way towards a peaceful society, now overflows with desperate families fleeing unspeakable atrocities made even more unbearable by the magnification on modern social media. For families that had fled destruction and devastation, that train station, the welcoming crowds paired with unfailing German efficiency, offered safety and the hope of a brighter future. But despite these visions of hope, it is not good intentions alone that will bring peace to a world laid to waste by violence. European governments now quarrel again over how to deal with the influx of refugees and migrants. And even if a good solution can be found to the refugee crisis, it only deals with the symptoms of the crisis, not its cause: the spread of new forms of violent conflict. For too long, conventional methods have been applied to unconventional problems with little impact. Much policymaking continues to be based on intuition, prior experience, and ideology. We must move beyond old ways of thinking to confront the new challenges of global conflicts. Traditional security, diplomacy, and military considerations
must be coupled with social and economic policies based on rigorous analysis. These dimensions interact in complex ways to make this new era of conflicts, especially non-state and sub-state conflicts, difficult to understand, anticipate, and resolve. Fortunately, we have begun to see the emergence of a new generation of scholars who are using the toolkit of modern social science, mathematical modeling, data-driven analysis, and randomized field experiments, to name a few, to make important and sometimes counterintuitive discoveries about the underlying causes of conflict. Consider the possibilities now open to us through the Pearson Institute. What if we really understood what motivated terrorists? Our own Ethan Buena de Mesquita has asked this question and found that, contrary to popular belief, terrorists are neither poor nor educated. Rather, terrorist organizations, like any organization, carefully assign highly educated operatives to more difficult missions. So, education programs, well-intended as they may be, can be counterproductive, merely increasing the supply of highly skilled operatives if they are not coupled with investment in new job and economic opportunities. These and other insights are examples of a new paradigm of how to think about global conflicts, a paradigm not based on wishful thinking, ideology, or conventional solutions, but the fearless pursuit of rigorous inquiry based on the best science of our day. It is not hard to see the potentials of these insights, often challenging conventional wisdom. For policymaking, but up until this moment, the barriers to accelerating this kind of research and getting it to policymakers have been too great. Together, the Pearson Institute and the Pearson Global Forum will fill this critical gap. The first of their kind, they will serve as a much-needed focal point for the study and resolution of global conflicts. The Haass School was created on the belief that rigorous quantitative research is the best guide for public policy. The mission of the Pearson Institute is the perfect expression of this belief. Nothing of the Pearson Institute's scale or scope has ever been attempted. Its goal, simply put, are to transform our thinking about global conflicts, equip the next generation of policy leaders to put these insights into practice, and convene the world's leading policymakers and scholars to find innovative and effective solutions to resolving violent conflicts. There is no limit to what we can do if we embrace the power of data-driven research to break through the tough questions that have stood in the way of progress. Thanks to the generosity and vision of the Pearson family, we are in a position to change the world. That task begins today. Thank you. And now, I would like to introduce Richard Haass, President of the Council on Foreign Relations. Dr. Haass is in his 13th year as head of the Council. Among his numerous accomplishments, Dr. Haass served as chair of the multi-party negotiations in Northern Ireland, for which he received the 2013 Tipperary International Peace Award. From January 2001 to June 2003, Dr. Haass was director of policy planning for the US Department of State, where he was a principal advisor to Secretary of State Colin Powell. Confirmed by the US Senate to hold the rank of ambassador, Dr. Haass has also served as US coordinator for foreign policy towards the future of Afghanistan. In recognition of his service, he received the State Department Distinguished Honor Award. Please join me in welcoming Richard Haass.
Well, good morning. And I want to begin first and foremost by congratulating Tom and Tim Pearson and the entire Pearson family. And while I'm in the generosity mood, I also want to congratulate the University of Chicago and its president, Bob Zimmer, on this extraordinarily important undertaking. One that, as you have heard and seen, will create both the Pearson Institute for the Study and Resolution of Global Conflicts, but also the Pearson Global Forum here at the Harris School. And let me just say something at the outset that I applaud and I marvel at the scale and the design of the undertaking. Because as you've heard, it does have multiple dimensions. It includes research, it includes convening power, and it includes and embraces education. And from my experience, a lot of what we call history results from the intersection of people and ideas. And this new institute and this new forum embrace both. Now, truth be told, I feel a little bit awkward standing up here today. The institute is devoted not just to studying, but to resolving conflict. Alas, I've had a lot more experience with the former than the latter. In government at various times, I was the US envoy towards the Cyprus negotiations as well as the Northern Ireland negotiations. And I was heavily involved in diplomacy involving Israel and its neighbors, as well as diplomacy involving India and Pakistan. And as you may have noticed, I did not succeed in resolving any of these conflicts. There is good news in this, however, from your vantage point, is that I've left this new institute and this forum plenty of work to take on. Now, at this point, I should probably confess one additional part of my past, namely that one of my books is titled Intervention and another Conflicts Unending. And I expect none of this was known before I was asked to speak today. But in my defense, along the way, I developed a theory of ripeness, that for any conflict to be settled, what is required is not just a formula and not just a process that the parties will sign up to, but most important, leadership that is both willing and able to make compromises. Unfortunately, what we see time and time again, though, is that such leadership is rare. That said, even when it is missing, even when you don't have leadership that's both able and willing to make difficult choices, there are tools to be employed and steps taken that can reduce the prospects of conflict and the severity of it if it were to happen all the same. There are also things that can and should be done in order to alter or ripen contexts so that leaders are more likely and able to become peacemakers. The reality, though, is that it turns out that conflicts are often better understood as situations to be managed more than problems to be solved. It's for this and other reasons that conflict has always been a central part of international relations and of American foreign policy. And from all appearances, dealing with conflict, from preventing it to waging it to dealing with the aftermath of it, will continue to be a central part of the world and this country's relationship with the world. There continue, for example, to be actual and potential conflicts between states, although there is good news here, in that in today's world, conflicts between states turn out to be more potential than actual, or simply much more rare than they used to be. Also positive, and it's rarely noticed, is that largely missing from our world is either the reality or the serious possibility of great power conflict. This gets little attention. It's a bit like oxygen. It's central, but we don't remark upon it regularly. But think about it. The fact that great power conflict is not just absent, but highly, highly unlikely, constitutes a fundamental departure from much of history, and especially, say, from the history of the 20th century, which was marked by two ruinous world wars and by a Cold War that mercifully, for the most part, stayed cold. I say this not to be complacent, as recent events in Europe involving Russia and Ukraine have shown. The use of military force to alter borders is still with us. Indeed, we just marked the 25th anniversary of Saddam Hussein's invasion and attempted absorption of the independent country of Kuwait. And as for the future, I would argue the most troubling possibility of what you might call classic or traditional conflict between states is the potential for clashes among the many powers of the Asia-Pacific region, which is likely to be the decisive venue for much of the yet-to-be-written history of the 21st century. But what I believe is so different about the era we are now in is that the dominant challenge to order comes less from the classic or traditional wars between and among states than it will come from violence and conflict within weak and failing or failed states. The Middle East is obviously the principal example. And what we are seeing there today, and if I am right, and I hope I'm not, and the good news is I'm often wrong, but if I am right and we are in the early stages of what might be a latter day 30 years war, what we are seeing are multiple challenges to state authority and indeed to the fundamental notion of sovereignty itself. And these challenges are coming from non-state actors and various subnational groups. And outsiders, hardly limited to this country, have made the situations in many cases worse, both by what they have done and what they have chosen not to do. And to paraphrase something that Tom Pearson said, waiting may or may not be an option. It may or may not be the right policy under any circumstances, but I would simply say, and I make this point in particular to students, whenever you think about what the choices are, not acting is just as consequential in any situation as acting. And the option of not acting ought to be analyzed and assessed with every ounce as much vigor as all the options of actually doing things. But whatever the cause or causes of conflict in the Middle East or elsewhere, what we are seeing now is the results. And as you've heard up here before, the results are horrific in many cases in terms of lives lost, people displaced, and societies and economies disrupted. And this is not limited, by the way, to the Middle East. Such problems are to be found, say, in Africa and in South Asia. And it's also important here to consider potential new sources of conflict. And let me just mention two. One is the consequences of climate change, which could create conditions where you then have movements of people or deterioration of economies, which could sow the seeds of conflict. And something I've been thinking a lot about and we're working on a lot at the Council on Foreign Relations, which is the new domain of cyberspace, where the rules for what is to be allowed and what is to be banned have yet to be written. And let me just say, the challenge here is arguably of comparable importance. The challenge here in the realm of cyberspace, it's of comparable importance, I would argue, to what was the case after the emergence of nuclear weapons after the Second World War. And at that time, you had the response of deterrence theory and arms control. I would actually argue that we need something no less creative and no less ambitious now for how to deal with this new realm of cyberspace. The Pearson Institute, thus, in all these areas, has not just an opportunity, but let me say an obligation to make a difference, to provide a venue where the best and brightest can meet, a home where scholars and practitioners can come together to draw lessons from what has been tried in the field and to produce policy relevant findings and policy relevant recommendations. And these findings and recommendations should deal with how best to use all the tools that are available for preventing conflict, to how to use all the tools available for bringing existing conflicts to an end, and then how to use all the tools that are available for rebuilding and stabilizing societies that are coming out of conflicts. This should also be an institution where a new generation of men and women who understand issues of conflict and who are committed to doing something about them, where they can at one and the same time and one and the same place learn about big ideas and big data. So these are great and these are exciting tasks, and they are also critical. So I want to end where I began, by thanking the Pearsons and the University of Chicago for making the commitment to take on these issues and taking on these missions. Let me just say, everyone in this room and everyone also not in this room has a stake in their collective success. Thank you very much.
If you're in any way engaged in the world, you can't help but clearly understand the nature and the proclivity for global conflict in today's world.
There's no more pressing issue in our judgment than the study and potential resolution or reduction of global conflicts. In large part, it's become our mission.
Understanding the problem and doing something about it are two different things. It's the doing something about it that is consistent with the Pearsons.
That family thinks big. They may have come from a small town in the Midwest, but there is something within them that thinks on a very broad scale.
When you give a gift on the scale that the Pearson family is giving, you are connecting with your real values.
Our father was a Methodist minister. Our mother was a homemaker raising four sons, but she also found time to teach at the collegiate level.
It was not uncommon at all to have other theologians, missionaries, intellectuals, writers come home to dinner. And you can't help but, through that exposure, develop an interest in the world.
I think what drives Tim and Tom is a desire to solve a world problem, and they have focused on global conflict.
Over the last 5 to 10 years, Tim and I have had an opportunity to meet and interface with a number of the Nobel Peace Prize laureates. It was a result of that experience and those discussions that we came to realize that individuals can make a difference.
The Nobel Association was a good fit for the Pearsons. They both share the lofty ambitions of making the world a better place. I think this started in the right place with Nobel as the inspiration.
This relationship and partnership that they now have with the University of Chicago is absolutely perfect.
When I heard from the Pearsons about this gift, I was blown away. I had no idea they were talking about a gift of this magnitude or something would have this enormous impact.
This is an incredible legacy, a legacy of ideas, and ideas that will generate new ideas and new solutions to issues that emerge that we can't even imagine today.
On behalf of myself and my three brothers, we're very, very gratified with the first steps that are being taken toward the creation of the Pearson Institute.
If we change one life, we've been successful. If we change millions of people's lives because of our ability to inform policy, we don't believe that there's any greater legacy as a Pearson family than we can leave for the world.
It is now my pleasure to introduce Timothy R. Pearson. Mr. Pearson is a sought-after business advisor and philanthropist, and is founder, president, and CEO of Pearson Advisors and Partners, a marketing management consulting firm that serves Fortune 1000 clients. He is a frequent keynote speaker and lecturer, and the author of the New York Times bestseller, The Old Rules of Marketing Are Dead. Previously, Mr. Pearson served for almost a decade as vice chair, global managing partner, and Chief Marketing Officer for KPMG, the global Big Four accounting, tax, and consulting firm. He also was president and CEO of a leading international management consulting firm. Earlier, he was president of several advertising agencies where he led award-winning initiatives for leading global companies. Mr. Pearson is active with numerous civic and charitable organizations And in 2012 and 2013, he and his brother were the first global benefactors of the Nobel Peace Prize Concert and the Nobel Peace Center in Oslo, Norway, through the Thomas L. Pearson and the Pearson Family Members Fund. He has also served on the Nobel Peace Center's advisory board. Mr. Pearson graduated cum laude with a BA degree in English literature from DePauw University. Please join me in welcoming to stage Tim Pearson.
Good morning. In the next few minutes, I've been asked to talk about, for a brief few minutes, about our family's journey as philanthropists. But first, I'd like to do something else. I'd like to thank each of you for being here today to help us celebrate this important undertaking between the University of Chicago, the Harris School, and the Pearson family. Your support and encouragement means everything to us. So, let's talk about our journey. Actually, our story is not all that unusual. Essentially, it's the story of Midwestern roots wrapped up in the pursuit of the American dream. In a few words, the Pearson Institute and the Pearson Global Forum is the result of the American dream. At its core, it's the consequence about dreaming about doing something really important, something really worth doing. You know, in all honesty, our family was like most families in the 1950s and 1960s. We grew up in the middle class, and actually probably with some reflection, the lower middle class. Our father in the early years was a young minister barely earning enough to feed and clothe his family. As Tom said, our mother was the daughter of a Kansas minister and a stay-at-home wife before she returned to teaching theater and religion at the college level. She was charged with raising four boys, Tim, Tom, David, and Philip, in small Iowa towns. I'm sure you haven't heard of any of them. St. Ansgar, Little Cedar, Esterville, Spencer, and even a lake called Lake Okoboji. You know, from an early age, we were taught the things that Midwesterners are typically taught. The value of putting in a good day's work, honoring our commitment, striving to excel and to always do our best, regardless of what the task or undertaking was. We were taught that the best life is to lead a meaningful life. That if you're able to do just a little bit every day, that over time, your actions can actually overwhelm the world. Probably the first time we truly came to understand the sense of personal sacrifice was when we were in the middle grades. As school ended that year, our parents sat us down and shared with us that our father would be gone for most of the summer. And I must admit, initially we did not understand why. We didn't even recognize the significance of the nondescript package and the inherent threat that was left on our doorstep one July evening with the warning, the Klan is watching you. It wasn't until some years later that we came to fully appreciate that our father had spent the summer in the Deep South with voter registration and had participated in the march from Selma to Montgomery. To this day, as a constant reminder, each of the four sons keeps a framed copy of the Klan's warning in one of our father's last sermons titled, I Sat Where They Sat, proudly hanging on the walls of each of our offices. You know, so from a very early age, we were instilled with not only a sense of social justice, but an awareness of the significant and most important international issues of our time. The things that threaten contemporary civilization, things like nuclear proliferation, armed and violent conflict, energy availability, poverty, and hunger. As the global benefactor of the Nobel Peace Concert and the Nobel Peace Center in Oslo, we saw firsthand what individuals can do, but we were looking to make a more direct and a more significant contribution. So quite simply, our hope for the Pearson Institute and the Pearson Global Forum is this. Our ambition is to leave the world a better place as the result of our gift. Our wish is, in the coming years, that the insights and findings of the Pearson Institute can transform the world that we live in together in some small way. The mission of the Pearson Institute, to contribute to a global society at peace, is to us truly important. But we anticipate the journey will be daunting. To find new ways to study and understand global conflicts, to significantly and meaningfully impact and inform policy, and to share these findings through the Global Pearson Forum by annually convening leading scholars and policymakers to maximize the potential for impact and preventing and resolving global conflicts. Something that has the real potential of making a significant difference in our world and advancing humankind. The Pearson family is fully committed. We're all in. We're fully committed to making a difference. In our hearts, we passionately believe that along with other like-minded individuals and philanthropists, we will overwhelm the world one small action at a time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pearson. I want to take a brief moment for some housekeeping. We have the opportunity now for members of the media who are attending this morning to ask our participants about this announcement. For our audience, please know there will be an opportunity for our audience question and answer session later in the program. But for now, we would like to take questions from the media before they leave us to report on this exciting announcement. For the media, we ask that you limit your questions to the topic of our announcement here today. If you have further questions for any of the individual speakers, we will have the opportunity for interviews immediately following this session. Please speak with one of the university staff here in the theater or join us in the McCormick Tribune Lounge immediately following. And now I'd like to invite all of our participants from this morning to retake the stage. And for our first question.
I'm Dick Johnson with NBC5, and I can't believe, Tom and Tim, that I'm sitting here as a former classmate of yours at DePauw and friend asking this question, or a question.
Make it easy.
On this, I'm trying. On this, and of course I will, on a remarkable gift. As I said to the folks managing this event when they first told me about it, And as one of the speakers said today, I'm blown away. Let me ask you, though, with the daily images we see that are so hard to look at of the children and families leaving Syria, and with the news today of Russian airstrikes in Syria, and as I walked into Mandel Hall, we did not know the exact targets they had. Compared to this incredible gift and this incredible effort that is being undertaken versus the practical needs that we see day to day, how do you, and I must ask, how frustrating is it for you to see those daily images, know there's immediate practical needs, and yet know there's also a need for long-term study and better solutions?
I'll let you.
Okay.
Tim's the oldest, so I always have to let him go first.
Can I still call you Dick? You know, when you're trying to figure out how to do something meaningful, you face a challenge, which is, do you try to do something short-term or you try to do something long-term? The reality is this is a very, very complex issue. There are cultural factors, economic, military, policy. Our belief, though, is that if you really want to change the world, if you really want to make the world a better place, you have to do those things that affect it and make it, and make those changes for the long term. So is it frustrating to see those things short term? Absolutely. But I think that you've got to go to the systemic issues, and that certainly will be the undertaking by the university to deal with the problem for the long term.
Dick, if I can maybe just piggyback on Tim's comments. Tim and I started our discussions along with our two brothers, Phil and Dave, over 4 years ago. So our planning with regards to what we wanted the Pearson Institute to be, the scope, the university that we wanted to become affiliated with and partner with, again, that started 4 years ago, long before some of the issues that we see in the headlines over the last 2 or 3 months. I guess the good news is that Tim and I saw a need. We had no idea that the need was going to be as great as it is. I wish I could say that we had research available today that could be applied to the situations in which we find not just this country, but a number of countries around the world. It will take some time, but the fact is, I think by even starting this effort, it's the first step, maybe in a long journey, but it is the first step. So I try not to be frustrated because I know there's a number of steps ahead of us.
Can I say something here? I want to back up the brothers here. $100 million is an extraordinary sum of money by any accounting. But if you're talking about 8,000 people a day showing up on Germany's borders in its cities, as important as it is, it wouldn't get you that far. It's not to discourage people from contributing, but there's a sense of scale here. But if you take a step back and you asked about Syria, there's very little that's happened in Syria. I would argue that's inevitable. If you look at the last nearly 5 years, you look at the series of decisions that have been made, what I would call acts of commission and omission alike, by local actors as well as the United States and others. We've got to learn from that. There are some very important lessons, I would think, to be drawn that might have consequences for the future of Syria, but also other places. We've got four failed states in the Middle East. We've got Libya, Syria, Iraq, and Yemen. We have the challenge of those four, as well as potentially other challenges in that region and beyond. We have got to begin taking stock of what we've learned, and then we've got to feed it into policymaking, because whatever else you may think of it, we're not doing a good job now. So I think the idea of looking, you know, again, there's room in life to intervene at many scales and many levels, and there's a place now for humanitarian relief. But to really take advantage of an institution like this and to train a new generation of people who can learn from this and, again, apply the lessons and hopefully go in and out of government or NGOs or international agencies and make something of a difference, that that could, over time, actually scale up in ways that even immediate grants cannot.
And our next question.
Hey, my name is Mitch. I'm with the Sun-Times newspaper. And I was wondering if you could talk about the process that led you to the University of Chicago and whether or not the decision-making process considered options closer to some of these conflict zones.
Well, again, Tim and I started over 4 years ago, and we looked at, all due respect, at 10 to 12 different universities.
You made the right decision.
Well, believe it or not. I was getting to that because we are here today. we looked at a number of factors, but at the end of the day, in Tim and I's judgment, and I think for Phil and Dave as well, it was a very easy decision. This is the perfect place for the Pearson Institute, and we're looking for a very, very long-term partnership that will hopefully have the success that we'd like.
My name is Greg Borzo. I'm a freelance writer, and I wondered if you have already plans about where the forum will actually take place.
That's to me.
So we're today at the day of announcement. It will take some time to set up the institute, appoint the directors, appoint the faculty, and also to design the forum. So at this point, we haven't decided on a location yet. The main goal for us is really to make sure that it becomes an effective convening place where academics and policymakers can come together to find effective policy solutions.
Great. And I'm afraid that's all we have time for today from the media, but thank you, gentlemen. Thank you to the media. And for the rest of you, I want to invite you to stay for our next panel discussion. Up next, we have a panel discussion moderated by Professor Ethan Bueno de Mesquita from the Harris School. But first, a little housekeeping.
And thank you.
After this next panel discussion ends, there is a lunch for Harris students in Hutch Commons. You must have RSVP'd earlier to attend this lunch. Then at 1:30, everyone here is invited to join Professor Bueno de Mesquita and three international scholars for a symposium on their work on global conflicts in Hutch Commons. Tonight, our musical guests from this morning, John Andrasik, and his band Five for Fighting, are playing a concert here in Mandel Hall. The Pearson family has made this special event possible, and I hope you'll join us for this community-wide celebration and bring your friends. Doors open at 9 p.m., and don't forget to bring two forms of ID. And now, we have a panel discussion on the new era of global conflicts, using data-driven analysis to understand and prevent violence. Because we have such a large audience here today, if you have questions during the panel discussion, please email them to harrisschool@uchicago.edu. Again, that is harrisschool@uchicago.edu. We will gather your questions and share them with our moderator. Ethan Bueno de Mesquita is professor and deputy dean at the Harris School of Public Policy. Dr. Bueno de Mesquita's research and teaching focus on political violence, the internal organization of rebel groups, formal political theory, and electoral accountability. He is the founding director of the Harris School of Public Policy's Center for Policy Entrepreneurship. He graduated from the college with honors and received a master's degree and PhD in political science from Harvard University. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Bueno de Mesquita and our distinguished panel.
All right.
Thanks for staying. So the study and resolution of violent conflicts obviously requires the collaboration and combined efforts of people working across sectors, from the government and the military, multilateral organizations, non-governmental organizations, the private sector, and of course the academy. And so to get this conversation started today at the launch of the Pearson Institute, we have a panel of distinguished speakers from across many of those sectors who I have the privilege of introducing and moderating a discussion among. So immediately to my left, Joe Felter, retired from the US Army as a colonel following a distinguished career as a Special Forces and Foreign Area Officer. He now conducts conflict research as a senior research scholar at Stanford Center for International Security and Cooperation and a research fellow at the Hoover Institution. Julie Smith directs the Strategy and Statecraft Program at the Center for New American Security. She's held posts in both the Pentagon and the White House, most recently serving as Deputy National Security Advisor to Vice President Biden from 2012 to 2013. Simon Henshaw has spent 30 years with the US Foreign Service, currently serves as Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary for the Bureau of Population, Refugees, and Migration, and so is a very busy person at the moment. Ian Solomon is the Vice President for Global Engagement at the University of Chicago and formerly served as the United States Executive Director at the World Bank. And Jim Robinson is a renowned political economist, co-author of the book Why Nations Fail, one of the world's leading experts on political development, and as of this year, I'm happy to say, my colleague as a university professor at the Harris School, the first faculty member at the Harris School to hold that distinguished title. So this is our panel. So to get us started, I'm going to start with a question for you, Julie. So from the decisions we've made over the last couple administrations in conflict zones, from the decisions to invade Afghan and Iraq, how we responded to the Arab Spring and its aftermath, the drug war in Mexico, decisions about whether and how to intervene in conflicts in Libya, in Yemen, in Syria, and elsewhere, to the current refugee crisis, we faced countless major policy decisions in conflict zones. And you had the opportunity to participate firsthand in many of those decisions. And so I wonder if you'd start us off providing some insights into sort of what your perceptions are of the strengths and weaknesses of how the government thinks and strategizes about those kinds of issues, and how the academy and evidence-based research has and should play a role in those decision-making process.
Great. Well, thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you to the University of Chicago for getting me out of Washington. It's a pleasure to be back in the Midwest. I'm from the Midwest. And congratulations to the Pearson family for this remarkable gift and very innovative new center that I'm looking forward to learning more about as you go forward. I wanted to say just a few things today about how things look down in Washington. And I guess the short answer is we're overwhelmed and we're flailing and struggling to frankly keep up to what we're dealing with today. What we're looking at right now is an unbelievable complex set of global challenges, and we find ourselves as policymakers essentially trying to play three-dimensional chess. We are now dealing with an array of actors that is unlike anything we face in our history. We're dealing with great power politics, maybe not great power conflict, as Richard Haass noted. We're dealing with rogue regimes, the likes of North Korea and Iran. We're dealing with an array of non-state actors. And we're now dealing with super empowered individuals that have access to technology and assets that we never imagined possible. Simultaneously, we're dealing with an array of threats that also feel breathtaking. We have conventional threats, the likes of what we've dealt with for the better part of 60, 70 years, traditional, conventional military threats. But we're also dealing with a huge array of hybrid and asymmetric challenges for which we are completely unprepared. And the pace with which these challenges are coming at us is overwhelming. You find yourself in government unable to keep up with the breaking news that comes in on a 24/7 news cycle. And as a result, you're dealing with this huge array of complex challenges with a toolkit and tool set that is entirely outdated and ill-equipped to deal with these cross-cutting challenges. So as policymakers, you're sitting there in the Situation Room trying to deal with 90-minute meetings that range from Yemen to Libya to Iraq to South China Sea to Russia's annexation of Crimea in the span of, say, 90 minutes to 2 hours with a toolkit that looks much like it did in the 1960s. And so one of the reasons I'm so excited about this center is it is going to be providing new ideas, new research, a new toolkit, and hopefully enable us as policymakers to get out ahead of some of these conflicts. The very last thing I'll say, if I could, is that 2014 was a year of surprises. The US government was caught by surprise by the annexation of Crimea. It was very much caught by surprise by the outbreak of Ebola, and definitely caught by surprise by the rise of ISIS. And that was a rude awakening in many ways for the US government to realize we don't have any grip whatsoever on preparing ourselves to deal with what's coming down the pike. And so to the extent that this center can help us think through what drives conflict, what the roots of conflict are, what new tools we need to develop to deal with the array of these complex challenges, I think that would be highly welcomed and appreciated. And the degree to which we can bring these academic communities and merge it with the practitioners and policymakers, all the better.
One of the things that I think to build on what you said, Julie, is our institutions, our tools and our institutions are designed for a different era. So we have institutions that focus on security matters, which don't know how to integrate very well with institutions that focus on development matters and the economic issues, which don't know how to relate very well with institutions that focus on issues of justice and inequality in the world. And how do we create these sort of structures where we can get the different elements of solving these problems talking together, working together, so that we can solve them? I think is a real challenge, and something that I think that an institute here at the University of Chicago, because of its emphasis on interdisciplinary dialogue. Right? If you want to solve a problem, and the New York Times reported a few weeks ago about 30,000 people going to join ISIS, being recruited by ISIS. If we want to understand why that is and what we can do about it, we need game theory experts like Ethan. We also want to have psychologists. We want to have people who work on issues of refugees and migration. We need people from security backgrounds. We need people who can understand the range of impacts, whether it's law and institutions, public policy. So this institute will be a forum to bring those different voices and hopefully supplement what people in Washington struggle with.
So Joe, you sit in a unique kind of perch here for us, right? You've had the experience as a government actor and decision maker, and also now as an academic researcher, you've come into the fold. I'd be interested in your take a little bit on these kinds of issues and some of the practicalities of it. What does it look like from the government side collaborating with academia, which I know you did during your time in the military, and what does it look like now from the academic side trying to collaborate back, and how's it gone? What have you achieved, and what are the barriers?
Ethan, again, echoing everyone here, just my sincere thanks for being here, for being invited. This is just an extraordinary effort by the Pearson family, and it's a real honor to take part in this today, because I do think it will change the world. But to your question, here we are at University of Chicago, which is known for a lot of its great economists. So let me throw a real complex economics theory out there, supply and demand. I think there is a demand for evidence-based research out there. As Julie said, the practitioners in the field, in the military, in government, and aid organizations, they're just too busy. They're putting out fires, and there are those that are equipped with the tools to help understand how to prevent those fires from starting. But it's connecting that demand with the supply. And that's a real challenge, because my experience in the military and to some degree in government and aid organizations, there's a lot of individuals very talented, very capable, working very hard. But the truth is, and this may sound a little elitist, which I can probably get away with at one of our country's top universities, some of the brightest people, the brightest minds, they're not out there in USAID, in the military, in the State Department. Although we've got some really bright people in those organizations, don't get me wrong. But they're in these great universities like Chicago and some others that I'm familiar with. How do you connect them? And I think you've got to create incentives. And I think I just missed that Vietnam generation, but my father served there. I think there's a legacy within academia from way back that's there's this distrust between academics and policymakers, practitioners. There's a lack of interest in working together. Those days are gone. I think there's a huge demand. My experience in the field, so we're working with really visionary leaders like General Petraeus, General McChrystal, and others. They want those tools. They're putting out the fires, but they want individuals to get involved. And it's the challenge is how do you create those mechanisms? And when I was in the field, so to speak, I remember my last tour in Afghanistan, bringing over some pointy head academics from what was that school in New Jersey? My colleague here, Princeton, was it? And some other great universities. They came over and they showed up, and this is some of the challenges, I think, speaking to the challenges. All of a sudden, these very, very bright folks come into a very different environment. I was in a special forces environment where a big, kind of some tough folks there, very skeptical of what can academics bring to the table. But when they show up at the table and add value, they are welcome at the table. And I think it's creating mechanisms to get them to the table. And it doesn't have to be physically. And I know we've got a great audience around the world down in here. It can be virtually. It can be the quality of the research and scholarship that makes it to them. And I would provide some of these senior leaders with credible scholarly studies that were actionable. Just a quick example, and I don't want to steal any thunder, cut me off if I'm taking too much time. In Afghanistan, we knew that civilian casualties weren't good, okay? On a moral level, killing civilians, bad, right? But we also knew somehow if we're going to counterinsurgency fight, it's you can't kill civilians and have collateral damage and expect to succeed. And General McChrystal knew this, everyone knew it, but it was based on a gut feeling. But no one really knew how bad it was. And we brought a team of academics over, and Professor Jake Shapiro is here today, you'll hear from him later, was one of these folks, came over there and did a very rigorous, methodologically rigorous, evidence-based study of the impact of civilian casualties on future violence. And had some, I remember the briefing to General McChrystal, he tapped his microphone, people listening all over the theater, like, guys, this woman from London School of Economics who was preventing these findings, and it was like this epiphany, like, here's evidence that our gut feelings, they're really backed up by research. So, just as one example, but again, my experience as a practitioner is there's demand for it, there's supply for it. Now that I'm back in academia, we got to keep up the fire. I think the Pearson Institute is a great example of the types of activities, the mechanisms that you need to build those relationships. When you have your first, is it the Pearson Forum annual meeting? Those relationships you build, you're going to develop a certain sense of trust. Those practitioners are going to go back to the field knowing your faculty here and others, like, wow, there's a relationship you build there. And that leads to one of the biggest challenges now. All this analysis and data-driven research is only as good as the quality of information and data that drives it. And sadly, that's one big barrier that we still face now is this sharing. If you're spending millions of dollars on a program, sometimes there's a certain concern that data-driven, evidence-based analysis is going to prove that you're doing the wrong thing. And sometimes there's a distrust that comes from that. So I'll leave it to my colleagues to respond. But supply and demand, it's there. It's creating those mechanisms to connect the brightest minds so they can work on our toughest problems because we can't afford not to. The stakes are too high.
I feel a little bit like the odd man out because my job isn't to avoid conflict, but to deal with the damage caused by conflict while I wait for others to fix it. But it's worth mentioning, I think, that even just 10 years ago, many of the refugee conflicts my predecessors dealt with had solutions and ended. But here in this era, we have new refugee crises coming at us, but not ending. That's why we have 60 million people now that are displaced. It's not like several years ago where things, Sierra Leone, for example, began, horrible crisis, was solved, ended. We don't see any end. So we're very, very dependent on data-driven analysis to figure out how to respond to these growing crises. And one example I can give you is that there's been a realization, it's obvious to those that work in the field, that more and more refugees are no longer located in traditional camp settings, but now 3/4 of them live in urban areas or towns and are not in camps. Well, that means something to people that work in my field because we were used to, for so long, providing services to people in a closed location where we provided all services. And when I say we, I mean the humanitarian community as a whole. But now we have people scattered throughout cities, so we need data on their needs, we need good analysis on how to provide to them, and we also need a bigger picture analysis on how to respond to changes among refugee populations. So without this kind of information, I don't think we can succeed in dealing to the small portion that we are right now with the growing crisis. So my thanks very much to the Pearsons for making this contribution. I believe that it will lead in important directions in helping us in our field. Last comment, whenever I say data-driven analysis, I think Joe made this comment too. It's not just the data, it's the analysis. It's got to be good analysis. It's got to be done by people who know what they're looking at, know what they're talking about, can be misused by the misinformed and ideologues.
I want to use the refugee crisis to as a launching point, maybe, to come back to something Julie said and also something that Richard Haass said in his remarks, which is the refugee crisis is on all our minds now, and we can see that there's sort of pressing questions to be asked about now. How do we respond? How do we help people live less miserable lives, maybe? How do we help stabilize the situation so they can get back home? There's these questions, right? There's a prior question, which is, I think Richard Haass referred to acts of omission and acts of commission. So we made some policy decisions about Syria and how to respond to the Syrian crisis, given the politics and the knowledge we had at the time. And I guess I'd be interested in your thoughts. Now we see what was presumably an unintended consequence of those policy decisions, which is a massive refugee and internally displaced persons crisis. And I think looking back or looking forward to whatever the next Syria is, if you think back on that decision-making process, what are the questions that you wish you had known answers to or even wished you'd known how to ask at the time that researchers going forward who are, as we've talked about, taking the long view here, might be thinking about?
Well, there are a whole host of questions I think we wish we would have asked ourselves. We found ourselves in the early years of the conflict in Syria focusing very much on the question of whether or not the U.S. should take a direct role. And the way in which we debated that and how we settled on an answer was very much tied to our experience in Iraq and Afghanistan. And it was tied to a limited resource environment and tied to the public mood that we find across the United States, an element of war weariness. And so we would sit down multiple times a week. We'd get a readout on the conflict, what's changed in the last 48, 72 hours on the ground. We would step back and ask ourselves, would U.S. direct engagement ultimately affect the outcome of this conflict? Oftentimes the answer, almost all the time, the answer was no. We would occasionally pull out our rusty toolkit and look at options like no-fly zones, arming the rebels, political negotiations, trying to reach a settlement, and see what tools fit for different elements of a U.S. strategy. But what we didn't succeed in doing, and yeah, I personally have some regret over this, and it haunts me, and Richard Haass was right to point this out. We did not ask ourselves about the consequences of not getting engaged. And while we were focused on the refugee crisis, we had a lot of meetings at the lower levels, at the mid-levels, at the highest levels, talking about our partners in Turkey and Jordan and Iraq and how they were coping with the refugee crisis, which was just beginning in those early years. We didn't step back, and this is where academia, I think, can help us, and think through not only the consequences of not having a direct role for the United States, but at what point would we hit a saturation point on the refugee front, and what is the worst case scenario? I mean, we have these strategy shops in the US government, we have policy planning units, we have a variety of people that are technically tasked to be asking questions, not in the short term, but the medium and long term. But in truth, they're not functioning as they should for an array of reasons. And this has been a longstanding problem, just not a problem we've seen with the Obama administration. A lot of these shops end up being speechwriting offices, and they're not able to properly do their job. We did some red teaming of U.S. policy in 2012 and 2013, but not enough. And so I think for a center like the Pearson Center, you can be asking, not only can you be driving solution sets to practitioners and strengthening the connectivity between academics and policymakers, but you can be asking the questions that we feel like we don't have the time in a 90-minute meeting in the sit room to ask ourselves, and to be driving that debate about the consequences of not intervening. I mean, we now have had three really interesting experiences. We've had Iraq and Afghanistan, the US is all in. We've had Libya, which was kind of a pinprick, limited military operation, primarily from the air, short-term in nature, about 6 months, with nothing on the back end. And we're seeing the consequences of that. And we've had Syria, where the United States has decided essentially to do very little, if anything at all. And so the $64,000 question is, looking at these experiences in terms of US leadership, what lessons do we draw from these various interventions of being all in for 10 plus years and essentially doing nothing? And how do we right set that now? What is the path forward for the United States in terms of how it uses these assets, which military, diplomatic assets, you know, our rich diplomatic community, development assistance, economic assistance, a whole array of tools. How do we use that to apply the use of US power? And we, the practitioners, as you noted, I mean, we're just running too fast. We can't take the time to have those meetings. We would always say, you know, at some point we should really have a meeting and test, kind of look back at our core assumptions on Syria. And you know what? We never had that meeting. Because you're just running, you're it's like spinning plates, something's always dropping, and you get, you know, suddenly there's a Kony video and you're like, oh my God, we've got to have a meeting on Kony, and you know, you're distracted by whatever's in the news or on Twitter in that snapshot of time.
And I think by the time you're in the Situation Room on many of these conflicts, it's almost too late. I mean, the fundamental challenges of long-term institution building in areas of the world that are not currently in the headlines, but where we are facing the potential for, you know, spiraling out of control in areas of criminal violence and narco trafficking and human trafficking, where there are vulnerabilities and fragilities in many parts of the world, where we should be thinking about now, how do we invest in legal institutions and in justice institutions and building those institutions, which frankly, by the time it gets to, you know, the Pentagon, is on the list of things they're gonna get to when the next time we have a moment of peace to reflect. But that moment doesn't come. And I think one of the values of an institution like Chicago and the Pearson Institute is, you know, we can take the step back and also be objective. It's very hard, I think, for many elected policymakers to suddenly say, you know what, we're gonna change course. Voters don't want you to change course. The people who are reading your talking points on the Hill don't want you to change course. The ability to actually say, you know, we may have made a mistake. It's a very hard thing to do, but academic institutions in search of objectivity and truth have to do that, have to have the courage and the confidence to say, no, the data is pointing somewhere different. We need to change course here.
I've only been in this position for 2.5 years, and it always strikes me that when I started 2.5 years ago, we were still talking about the crisis in Syria ending fairly quickly, and that Syrians would be going back.
That's right.
We've been involved in the humanitarian side of this since the very beginning. Of the $4.5 billion that we spend in the region, half of that actually has gone into and it continues to go into inside Syria to support the displaced. The rest goes in the countries around. But if I think about what I would have liked to have done more of 2.5 years ago, which would have been to prepare for the long-term residence of Syrian refugees in Turkey, Lebanon, and Jordan. Though that's a really easy thing to say. 2.5 years ago, it would have been very hard to sell that to any of those three countries.
That's right.
And it's still difficult to some extent today, though they're facing that reality. And just one other point on another level. International humanitarian system is obviously strained by these crises, and there's a lot of talk about whether or not the international system we set up, which is sort of a post-World War II setup that was revamped in the 60s, fits today's world. And there's a lot of discussion, a lot of debate, people calling for that to be done, others concerned that if we started to open that discussion, there might be changes which would rip apart the parts that actually do work, such as UNHCR and others. But I urge you all to watch that debate, see where it goes.
So one of the things Ian said was that academia in general and the Institute, and the Pearson Institute in particular, it gives us this opportunity to step back and ask these questions that in the moment of a policy crisis, policymakers can't make. So I want to, we're at a university, I want to take a minute to do that. So if I think about the conflicts that we, the recent conflicts that we went most deeply into, and I think about Afghanistan and Iraq, and I think about the kind of policy levers we tried to use, not at the very beginning when it was primarily a military problem, but afterwards, when there were other kinds of problems. I think about a lot of the discourse being about economic development, and I think a lot of how we talk about conflict and conflict resolution is about economic development, which is, I think, straightforwardly important. But we have Jim Robinson here, who has sort of spent a lot of time suggesting another account and another set of concerns having to do with political development, having to do with state capacity, having to do with the breakdown of the state. And so I want to take a minute to think a little bit and ask you, Jim, if you have some reflections for us on how we should think about the competing and or complementary aspects of economic and political development. And you know, we can talk about that obviously in the context of Iraq and Afghanistan, or certainly in the context of Syria. We can also talk about it, and you've had a lot to say, in the context of the decades-long conflict in Colombia, about which there was also headlines in the last week. And so we open up that line of questioning.
Decade. 200-year-long conflict in Colombia.
200 years is a number of decades.
I mean, I think the relationship between economic development and all of this is very complicated. It was quite funny that when the gentleman was playing the piano, at some point a photograph flashed up of former Colombian President Andrés Pastrana shaking hands with Tiro Fijo, who was a former leader of the FARC guerrilla group. Just last week, the current president of Colombia, President Santos, was photographed shaking hands with Timoshenko, who's the current leader of the FARC guerrilla group. And you know, actually, you could put together a presentation for the whole musical piece of Colombian presidents shaking hands with various guerrilla leaders and paramilitary leaders and caudillos and rebels, and you know, and it sort of goes on, you know. And you know, when I look at that, I sort of think that, you know, in Colombian society, you could go back 200 years. You know, there's always this, let's make a deal, we make a deal, we make an agreement, you know, you have a little bit, we have a little bit. When Pablo Escobar, the famous drug lord, emerged, you know, they tried to make a deal with him too. They made him in, they got him into politics, they, you know, so what's the point of that? The point of that, I think, is that the endless sort of conflict in Colombia reflects the way sort of society is organized, reflects the way the state works, reflects the way society interacts with the state. It sort of reflects a generalized sort of lack of authority. And you know, so I look at that, I say, well, okay, so there's gonna be a peace agreement with these chaps at the moment, just like there were lots and lots of peace agreements in the past. In the end, the one with President Pastrana didn't work out, but lots of the other ones did work out. But the violence goes on, the conflict goes on, the anarchy goes on, the vacuum of authority in the country goes on. In the meantime, Colombia, education went up, life expectancy went up, income per capita went up. So there's been plenty of modernization, you know, over this period. So I think this is much more about the way authority is organized, the way the state is organized. And I would like to echo this comment about social psychology. You know, who could read the newspaper about Islamic State and not think, gosh, I really don't understand that. You know, a lot of this literature in conflict is about economics, the economic trade-offs, the costs, the benefits. It doesn't make any sense as an explanation for what's been going on. And, you know, anthropology, social psychology, you know, one of my own sort of personal problems, sort of trying to understand the things I'm interested in, whenever I get to some place, you know, I come with this baggage of social science theory and ideas. But it turns out that social science theory and ideas was developed by people in England and United States and Canada and France. You know, but the thing is, that's not very representative of how people are in the world, of people's psychology, of people's institutions, of people's social norms, the way society functions and coheres, the way authority works. And we just don't understand that well enough, because so much social science is a sort of projection of how England looks like into the rest of the world. And as I've worked over the years in Colombia, in sub-Saharan Africa, you just see you know, you have to sort of deprogram yourself to understand what's going on because you come with so many preconceptions. So I think, you know, one of the reasons this Pearson Institute is so exciting is that we can get all of that on the table. We can sort of think creatively, you know, do lateral thinking or whatever it is, you know, and just try to address some of these issues in a different way. So, you know, there's been, you know, economists have got interested in civil war, and but there's just, they come with their own tools and they say, oh yeah, this is an economic problem. So, you know, but it's a much broader thing than that, it seems to me. And I think that's what's so exciting about this initiative.
And if I can just piggyback on that, the notion of bringing these international voices into the conversation and how important that is. You know, we're joined, I think, by webcast with scholars in India and scholars in Paris. The university has centers that's set up across the world. We have one in Beijing, in Hong Kong, we have London. How do we get more voices into this debate so it's not a bunch of American or European always academics, but it's the academics from the developing world to get more of this, you know, the South-South voices and the South-North exchanges, because I think it will force us to ask a new set of questions.
Again, just a comment on that from the refugee world. There's a lot of study right now on looking at how we can greater integrate development with humanitarian work. Traditionally, they were seen as separate. Humanitarian work was just to keep people alive until they could go home or move on. Development work is obviously very different. But with more and more refugees living within host communities which need development projects themselves and not going home soon, we're looking at ways and we're experimenting with tying those two elements together. So that, for instance, when you're looking to help a humanitarian, a refugee group in a city in Lebanon, you also look at the host community and its development needs, and you bring in some development money to improve development, which also helps the refugee community. That's something, too, which is very much dependent on data and learning exactly what those communities need to move on.
Ethan, I think the understanding the role of economic development on conflict is, I think, a great example of the good that can come of a, you know, study here like at the Pearson Institute, because it's really counterintuitive. And my experience in the field is, hey, economic development, good. Jobs, good. Programs, good. Education, good. All these things, just intuitively you think that gut feeling, of course, if we do these programs, we're going to see the results we need. And we know, even without sophisticated evidence-based analysis, that's not the case. So economic development, I think, is a great field. I know you've done a lot of study yourself and others here in the room as an example of just how much closer, you know, to the nuanced truths we can get by this evidence-based approach. Or, you know, political development, too. In Afghanistan, they're just saying is, you know, counterinsurgency can only be as good as the government supports, and really understanding, you know, the barriers that, you know, short of some type of a legitimate governance, then any of your efforts in the other areas like security are just going to run into a brick wall. And it's those sophisticated studies with these diverse, you know, multidisciplinary academics and scholars, I think, are going to help us get closer to the truth.
And I would just echo that. I mean, the need for cross-disciplinary work is just greater than ever. I mean, we still have a government that is very much structured based on kind of a stovepiped approach. We have folks that, you know, have a regional expertise. They're a China expert or they're a Yemen expert. And then we have the functional experts. I do CT, I do WMD, I am a cyber person, whatever it is. And those worlds are having trouble coming together. As you noted, more and more we're finding the need to merge, say, the humanitarian assistance with the development folks or the refugee issues with development. We've got the Department of Energy now reaching out to state. Climate covers both the diplomatic community, but a range of other U.S. government agencies. And so finding both the individuals that can bring this type of cross-disciplinary work to the government is important, which I hope the Pearson Center will help with, but also helping our government think about the way in which they can structure their work so that you don't have teams off in separate corners not talking to each other and sharing important lessons and knowledge.
Joe, I want to put you on the spot for a minute. So we've been talking about humanitarian aid, economic aid. People didn't take my debate on my bait on political development. So I'm gonna push back on humanitarian aid a little. So you've written some of the most important studies of how we think about the relationship between humanitarian aid, development aid, and conflict. And you alluded in your comments the idea that there's some counterintuitive stuff there, but it's not just counterintuitive. Your studies and other of the best studies done by academics on this stuff, right, point to really severe unintended consequences kind of problems, that food aid can be stolen and turned into increased conflict rather than decreased conflict, that development projects can spark rebellion rather than these kinds of things. So I'm interested in a little bit of some of the substance of that research and hearing other people's reflections on what we think about that, what we think about the not just the nuances, but they're really the opposite of what we think kind of stuff, right? That there may be real unintended consequences of the programs that feel like they must be good to us. And then also from people who've been working in government, how those kind of findings sit in the decision-making process, right? How we take those on board when the best studies point to the things that we're spending a lot of money on and that seem like they sure sound like the kind of things good people would do to help the situation turn out to go the wrong way.
Sadly, there's just so many examples of these well-intended efforts to use economic development to reduce violence and address the roots of conflict. But it's really challenging, and it's my experience is like Iraq and Afghanistan, for example. Some of the biggest development projects actually we find with some studies really have no impact on reducing violence, and sometimes they have the exact opposite effect. Sometimes part of the budget for a big development project is a big security component. So if you subcontract that out, you got a bunch of money to provide security. Maybe you just pay off the Taliban not to attack your project for the period of time, and then you get security. And there's a serious unintended consequence. In a counterinsurgency environment, in a couple of cases, Iraq, Afghanistan, and the Philippines, which I've studied, the insurgents, the rebels, they have a vote. If the government goes in there and tries to bring development in, and they know that's going to undermine their position, well, they have a strong incentive to sabotage those development projects. So at times we'll see development projects increasing violence. It doesn't necessarily mean they're bad. It may be an example of this is a development project that sticks, that they really think it's going to undermine their position and bring support for the government. Which leads me to another point, Ethan, is you have to be careful how we, and I think you alluded to it, Simon, how you analyze the data that you have. And that's, or maybe that was you mean. Increase in violence may not necessarily be a bad thing always. And sometimes I get my context in Afghanistan, if there's a Taliban controlled area, you may see zero violence. You send a team in there to bring development and do the types of activities and security to wrest control back from the Taliban and towards the government, violence is gonna spike. So if you're sitting there in a briefing with a four-star and he's looking at violence spiking, if the briefer says, we got a problem in this area in Helmand, violence is going up, we're good over here in Kandahar. Well, maybe the exact opposite. Maybe we're not trying hard enough in Kandahar and this area in Helmand. We're actually there doing the hard work. So a long way of saying that understanding the impact of economic development is very challenging. I think it's one area that really lends itself to the types of contributions that scholars can make. Because it is hard, it's nuanced, it's conditional, and it's very important. And I think, again, your center is going to make some great progress there, and I hope to contribute to that from those other universities.
All right, so I have some questions that have come in to us from the audience. I apologize that we're not going to have time for all of them. But there's a few here that I'd like to pose to you all and see what your thoughts. So the first one here says, new forms of conflict and new conflicts involve new variables, new considerations. And they ask, is existing data adequate to identify and measure the things we really care about to think about resolving conflicts today and conflicts that are coming in the future? And if not, what are the things that we need to be measuring that we're not measuring, and how do we go about doing that? I started with a hard one. And I think we can think about how do we go about doing that, both in terms of, I mean, there's some measurement questions, and that's probably a little too much inside baseball social science for us, but there's questions about partnerships too, I think, in terms of putting the people who have thought about the measurement and the people who have access to the data together.
I can make a quick comment on that. That's a key, I think, to quality research is developing those partnerships. So those relationships that you're going to build here through your Pearson Forum, for example. There's a lot of data and information out there that is not being shared with academics for no good reason. There's maybe one column in that spreadsheet with a few names on it that prevents a trove of information from being shared. So any effort like the Pearson, your organization here, to create those relationships so you can do that, encourage that type of information sharing is key. And also with data, you have to be careful you get what you measure too. So I know that practitioners need to be careful. If the boss cares about some certain measure that that's all they're going to focus on. They may lose something in the noise. I think scholars can take a more objective approach to bringing in all the factors that may be causal.
I think it's hard to, there's some real work that needs to be done to define measures of things that are hard to measure, like the quality of governance. We have a couple of metrics there, you know, how long it takes to maybe get a judgment, how long it takes to, you know, maybe file a paper. I'm not sure any of them, we have the best measurements for understanding governance. We have the, you know, transparency metrics, but I think there's more work needs to be done thinking through the sorts of data we want to collect around this issue of institution building, which may be among the most important for long-term stability.
One of the things that some of the comments have already pointed to, I think, is in terms of kinds of data we look at and you get what you measure, is a question, an issue that came up in some answers to previous questions about, and lurking under all of this, is this issue about short-run versus long-run decision-making. And say, is an increase in violence, you know, this month a good thing or a bad thing? Well, that depends on whether it's in the service of some long-run goal or not. And so one of the things I'd be interested in hearing about is, and of course, you know, the issue of inside government making short-run decisions versus outside of government, is how we think about, from the perspective of doing the research and doing the decision making, how do we think about creating ways to think about the long run and not just the short run, which is a form of thinking about the right kind of data?
I mean, yeah, this is one of the biggest challenges for policymakers. You know, the president comes in, he or she will have, you know, any cabinet member, head of an agency, will arrive on the scene with a certain set of strategic priorities. And you think to yourself, okay, I am now leading this shop, I want to get X, Y, and Z done. The problem is the world doesn't cooperate, and it jerks you around, and you find yourself distracted and having to respond, and you lose sight. The problem of strategic attention is very real. And you see that even with this president focused now on legacy. He's worried about finishing the final year and a half in office, ensuring that he checks a couple of his core priorities, getting his objectives done. But he's pulled in 50 different directions by burning crises. And so the degree to which policymakers can find better ways to grapple with responding to today's burning fires, but maintaining that strategic attention, I mean, the rebalance is case in point. President Obama came in convinced, along with all the other members of his cabinet, that the United States needed to pivot to Asia. He's had a hard time maintaining focus on that objective in light of everything that's going on in the Middle East and a resurgent Russia and a whole array of other crises. And so thinking through how to assist a team of practitioners to give them the toolkit and finding even parts of the government that will be able to pursue that agenda while you have other people over here dealing with the issues of the day. I mean, that we're going to have to do a much, much better job at that. I mean, the one thing I would say for folks coming in from the outside with advice, with their research, information on big data they want to relay to practitioners, delivery is absolutely key. I mean, knowing that these practitioners have maybe an hour or two to be briefed, you have to have somebody come in, either from the private sector or academia, we need help from both sides, frankly, that have somebody who's had that exposure and understanding of where they sit and the challenges they face so that they can deliver the lessons from the big data or 10 years of research or on the ground, in the field lessons to a practitioner that's sitting there dealing with both the burning crises and trying to deal with their strategic priorities in a way that resonates with them. And I've seen, having been in government, countless meetings where someone comes in and they're scary smart and they're smarter than 50 of us in government put together, and you know you're about to be wowed, but the delivery just, they can't relay it in a form that gets into a delivery of, here's how you would apply this today, Mr. Secretary of State, Mr. Secretary of Defense, Mr. Vice President, whoever it is. And that's where I think this center will be able to play a helpful role in first convening these groups, but then hopefully giving the folks that are working in the center some exposure to some experiences in Washington so that they can have a better way of relaying those lessons and information.
I'll just look at it a different way. You know, I tend to think, like, since I'm English, like Winston Churchill, that countries get the politicians they deserve. So, you know, if people think, you know, politicians muddle through, I guess, but if people can think long-term or then the politicians will have to think long term. So there's a role for universities and education and, you know, just trying to get the message out and the ideas out and the perspective out.
But it's a give and take. I think that university leaders and academics need to learn to translate a bit more to policymakers, you know, and realize how to take long-term answers, but maybe using students, maybe using other people, break them into short-term steps you need to take. Right, so here's a long-term thing. It's not just for you, policymaker, to have this in the back of your mind as you're fighting 17 other fires, but here are three things you should do this week, in the next budget, in the next time the next G20 meeting, whatever it might be. Break it into some smaller bite-sized pieces, because I think otherwise the bandwidth's too small. The world's too complicated, and there's not enough time to deal with all the crises.
And you need to create incentives for these scholars to get involved in this work. Here's a challenge to the deans in the audience. You got to reward policy-relevant scholarship. I think there's incentives as it's set up now. As I transition academia later in life, I realize that, wow, you're almost penalized for doing policy-relevant research because it's not in a peer-reviewed journal that takes 2 years to get out. So I think if you can, and it sounds like you're doing it here, Ethan, if you can reward scholars for policy-relevant research, you're going to attract the level of expertise that these really important problems demand. And also for you scholars out there, we can't do real-time analysis for a fire that a practitioner has to put out. But don't be dissuaded from doing that hard work on a conflict that may have happened 5 years ago. Because, you know, if you do, you know, evidence-based, you know, quality research on something that occurred in Iraq or Afghanistan 5 years ago, those conditions are going to come up again somewhere around the world. When someone's trying to make a decision right now, you can almost have done the hard work, the heavy lifting, the critical thinking, and apply those lessons from that analysis to a current case. So I think there is value in scholarship, even if it's not real-time addressing today's problem.
So we have a...
Could I just make a plug for my bureau? Population, Refugees, and Migration is committed to funding academic studies. We've been doing that for a while. We cut out some of our budget every year, and it's very important for us, and we've used it to lay out long-term planning. And two areas we've done it, urban refugees, which I mentioned earlier, and also we've changed the way that the humanitarian system looks at responding to gender-based violence based on a number of long-term studies we've done.
So we have a question that invites us, I think, actually to think about in a more specific context, this kind of question about short-term versus long-term and how do you do it. So the questioner is interested in the Colombian conflict and points out, right, it's a long-standing conflict. There are these peace negotiations going on. As Jim points out, they may or may not fail. They've failed many times in the past. And so wants to know, suppose you were thinking right now, what kinds of questions should we be asking and answering so that we could make that a success over the long run? What would they be? If you have an answer,
I think there should be. I think there's the major problem is that I think it will happen, but it will happen, but it won't change the way anything works, like all the other agreements. So it doesn't. The peace agreement, you know, doesn't change the way the society works. It doesn't alter the root causes of the conflict. So I think there's insufficient attention to the root causes of the problem. You know, the discussion of the root causes of the problem in Colombia is like some sort of discussion from the 1960s and the Alliance for Progress, you know. So everyone is still sort of stuck in some rhetoric from the 1960s about inequality and land distribution. Of course, there's tons of inequality in Colombia, but, you know, there's lots of inequality everywhere in Latin America and even in the world, but it doesn't have the same consequences. So I would say the major problem, you know, would be, what's the root cause of all of this? No.
My understanding of the Colombian draft of an agreement, it has at least three elements. One is around land reform, and one trying to address some of the issues of you know, arguably either economy or inequality, but land reform is a key piece. Another is about justice and how and whether we can actually hold people accountable and what and it relies a lot on justice institutions that are going to be able to discriminate between different types of offenses by state actors and or by rebels. And the third piece relates to, you know, how we think about what's the third major theme in the Colombian agreement?
Political participation.
And getting, you know, people who have been on the outside somehow included on the inside. These strike me as three fundamental parts of a solution. And hopefully, I would hope that even if it's not a permanent peace, if there is room for more of this sort of analysis to figure out, okay, how do we now get to these root causes? Because just political participation strikes me as a fundamental issue to trying to unpack these 200 years of conflict.
Yeah, that would be true if political participation or lack of political participation was the reason the conflict started, but I don't think it was for a second. So, of course, these people want power, and everyone wants to exercise power, and they think we need to exercise power to avoid, you know, being, you know, because there's no commitment to anything. But, you know, I don't think anyone actually thinks they will exercise power. My impression is that they're desperately unpopular with the average Colombian, which is why they're trying to sort of rig the rules to make sure, at least in some pockets, they have power. So I don't think any of those things. I think land reform will never be implemented. There's a 50-year history of land reform in Colombia, which is never implemented because the state doesn't have the capacity to actually implement it in the areas where it's needed. There's just too many veto players and too many alternative powers embedded in the state. So I don't think that will be implemented. I don't think anyone actually thinks it will in Colombia, but you know, somehow they have to go through the motions of saying it. And the justice, well, let's see, you know.
So what advice do we give policymakers then? Sit back and say it's too complicated?
Which policymakers? Colombian policymakers or American policymakers?
Both. And maybe regional actors as well. What's the advice we give them, either in terms of data to collect or positions to stake out or aid to provide?
Yeah, one of the things which is sort of interesting about the negotiation is there actually has been the international community, at least these ideas about international justice have put some constraints on what it's possible to get away with. You know, meaning, you know, I know that the government had to spend a long time explaining to the FARC commanders that they couldn't just like, if they just can't walk away and, you know, kiss and make up because the international community won't put up with that. So people will start hauling them off to The Hague and they don't want that. So we have to do something, you know, so quite what something is going to look like is very unclear. You know, my sense is that they'll try to blame all the atrocities and massacres on people who've already been killed and say, oh yeah, Comandante Reyes, you know, terribly sad, but you know, he's been killed now, so it's all over, you know. So we're not really responsible for that. So there'll be a sort of trying to blame people who are kind of off the table. You know, if you look at, I mean, the model of the justice is actually based on the paramilitary demobilization in 2006. So, you know, all of the prison sentence and trying to decide what the crimes are and who's really guilty and not guilty, that's exactly what's been happening for the last 9 years with respect to paramilitaries in Colombia. And I don't know, you know, it's a sort of interesting process. And for a social scientist, it's generated a sort of plethora of interesting facts about what goes on in Colombia and these paramilitary groups. But justice is not a word that people in Colombia use about the paramilitary demobilization process. So I don't know how much justice. A lot of information has come to light about it. And you know, what to me the most interesting thing about that is that there has been some process of reflection and learning. You know, and I've seen paramilitary commanders, you know, actually sort of say, gosh, yes, that got really out of control and lots of things happened that we never anticipated and we regret. And so perhaps there is some possibility of collective, you know, I don't know what the right word is, catharsis or something. But I'm skeptic.
So we have, I think, time for one more question. Somebody from the audience asks about climate change. And they say, right, so we know, we think climate change is coming potentially in large scale and that this is going to have implications for refugees, it's going to have implications for conflict. And so they're asking us questions surrounding the question of how do we think about what are the collaborations scholars and governments should be having to get ready for thinking about those problems, for addressing those problems? What are the questions we should be asking that we're not asking surrounding the relationship of climate change and the issues of conflict and its aftermath that we've been talking about today?
There's a difference, of course, between refugees and migrants. That's very important in my field. It's often mixed up in the press and others. For some people, it doesn't really matter because they move along the same routes. But refugees are fleeing violence in general and want to go home and can go home once that violence ends. Migrants want to leave because the economic conditions in general from where they're coming aren't good enough to sustain them, and they want to go somewhere else. So climate change is contributing to migration right now. That is happening. The growth of the Sahel, the extension of dry conditions further south into Africa, the rising of the sea among several islands. So we are seeing the growth of migration, and that is that's not going to stop as we move forward, and needs to be addressed along with the whole question of migration, and what do we do about people who no longer can survive in the countries from which they came and are looking for somewhere else to go, where at the same time, in a lot of aspects, the first world is walled off.
I would just say in 2006 and 2007, we saw a pretty interesting debate take root in Washington about the national security implications of climate change. And it was nice because it brought kind of a new edge to the age-old debates, and we could get away from some of the partisan politics and think about the consequences of climate change from a national security perspective. And that got the attention of people in Congress that normally didn't want to talk about climate change. It certainly got the attention of the Pentagon. And as a result, we saw this administration come in and with the Quadrennial Defense Review, when the first version of the QDR came out under this administration, they had a heavy emphasis on climate. We now have the Pentagon very much focused on climate as a national security challenge. We certainly don't have all the answers, and I think this is a case where our own dysfunction at home is really hurting us abroad. And our inability, for example, to ratify Law of the Sea, a whole range of issues where our partisan politics are kind of covering us in a sea of paralysis, and not enabling us to be a partner to the international community, an active partner to the degree that I think many of us would like to see, is a real problem. So I think we're going to need the assistance of the private sector again. We're going to need the assistance of academia to think through not only the direct implications of what's coming, and again, that toolkit that we're going to need to respond above and beyond how many icebreakers we have in the Arctic right now, but also to think about the nexus increasingly between our domestic policy and the impact that it has on foreign policy. And this is a lesson that we seem to be learning now in double time about how our politics at home are really preventing us from being the actor we want to be abroad. And I think we're going to need the help of the academic community to make the case, do some research, help the American public understand that nexus and the importance of us and our ability to move forward and not let the dysfunction at home prevent us from leading.
And I think, as Simon says, we can actually predict some of these changes. Mm-hmm. We can look at where we're going to be seeing, you know, more migrants coming from and figure out where they're going to be going. And if you look at, you know, West Africa, for example, you have increasing numbers of migrants coming into West Africa, a region that's actually been doing reasonably well, about 7% economic growth for the past, you know, decade or so. And yet we have 60% of the people under the age of 25, so you have a large youth population. You have growing migrant populations. You have pretty high unemployment. You have commodity prices dropping. So you can actually predict some levels of instability in parts where they're actually very important for U.S. Geopolitical interest.
All right, well, I want to wrap up. We could keep talking about this stuff for a long time, and happily with the foundation of the Pearson Institute, we will indeed do so, but we are out of time for this morning. So as we conclude the morning session, I want to start by thanking the panelists for a great conversation.
Thank you.
I want to thank all of you for attending, and especially those of you who sent in questions. I apologize to those of you whose questions we didn't get to. We're going to break now for lunch, but we are reconvening at 1:30 in Hutch Commons, which is right behind us, for an academic symposium that's going to include talks by Professors Melissa Dell, Ruben Anakalapov, and Jacob Shapiro. And I'm sure that conversation is going to take these themes and develop them even more and have more deep and important things to say. I hope to see everybody who registered for that event at 1:30. Thank you.
Thanks to you. That was great.